After getting most of what he wanted from his proposed budget, Miami-Dade County Mayor Carlos Jimenez still has more work to do. One of the options in front of him is to veto the increased millage rates for libraries. Joining me to discuss this and other county news, we welcome Miami-Dade County Mayor Carlos Jimenez. Mayor, good to have you back.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
As of Friday night of this week, you have the option of vetoing what the commission recommended for the increase in millage for the libraries. What are you thinking of doing?
This is the preliminary millage. It just establishes a ceiling, and so I think I'm gonna let it all go. I got 95% of what I wanted, and so with that in that spirit, I'm gonna let that go for now. But remember, Helen, I also have two more opportunities later on when we actually establish the millages in September, and so I'm going to keep my options open.
And I'm going to assume the commission is also going to keep its options open. They set the ceiling, mm-hmm. as you suggest,
right.
And what they can do is lower it if they find that there's a need to lower. And there is some pressure that might come when trim notices come, because those trim notices are going to see increases in a lot of areas.
Yes.
And not necessarily related to the county budget.
Correct, but it has, Miami-Dade County is the one that sends out the trim notices, and trim notices spell out all the taxes for the school board, for your municipality, for Miami-Dade, for the South Florida Water Management District. All kinds of different taxes are in there. And so if a person sees a tax increase, they may say, oh, well, that's Miami-Dade County. Well, you really need to look at your trim notice to see where your increases are really coming from. And again, also remember that this is also the ceiling. These are all ceilings for all these different jurisdictions.
And they will see increases coming from Jackson Memorial Hospital because of the bonds?
Correct.
They will see it from Miami-Dade County Public Schools because of the bonds as well.
Well, I think I read somewhere today that actually that the millage wasn't going to go up for Miami-Dade County Schools in terms of the bonds themselves, because Miami-Dade County, the Miami-Dade County Public School System, their increase in the property values actually went up by 9%. Ours went up 7%, and that's a function of there are certain discounts, et cetera, that you get as from the county that you don't get from the school board. And so they've actually had a greater growth in the school board tax roll. And so with that, I think they'll be able to hold a line on the millage rate. But again, also, Helen, a lot of people will get increases in their property values. Even if you're homestead exempted, your property values probably will go up by 3%. That's what, you know, is allowed. And so with that, with the same millage rate, you're also going to see a little bit increase in what you have to pay out.
When we look at some of the ways, and you and I have had conversations since you were a county commissioner as to how to deal with county budget and find greater efficiencies. And one of the things that we've talked about is the pay process for county employees. There are over 2,000 steps or ways to get an increase. A lot of them are pretty automatic. There are, every year, the county commission votes in favor of a pay plan. Then you have the leave plan, where the public considers parachutes are in there for people who are leave. You get paid for sick days that you don't take.
Correct.
Which is as if you were working extra days. You just didn't get sick, so you're getting paid extra because,
right.
I don't know, after you worked for 30 years, nobody was sick for those 30 years. And
right.
That's
well, if you,
I mean,
if
is
you,
there
if you, didn't, if you didn't take the sick days, then you get paid for a certain amount of them. And so
should that be addressed?
It should. You should have a cap on that. You don't want to say that you don't get anything, because then you'll incentivize people taking their sick time, which then increases your cost anyway. And so you've got to strike a balance. You can't allow these huge balances to accumulate, but you can't go down to zero, because again, at the end, what will happen is somebody will probably call in sick for about a year, okay, and not show up. And that's not something that we want to do, because we want to keep, you know, our employees productive. And so you got to strike a balance there. There are starting pays that aren't really starting pays. Police is a great example. You have a certain starting pay that looks kind of competitive with the rest of all the different police departments in the county. But when you really look at it, they get something that's called FDLE pay. They get something which is called first responder pay. They get automatically. Those kind of things really need to be rolled into the base so that we all can look at things from apples to apples and not apples to oranges kind of comparison. And so there are a lot of pay steps. The payroll system in Miami-Dade County is incredibly complicated. I think in in the federal system, there may be like 50 or 60 different pay grades. In Miami-Dade County, there's 2,000. And so that's something that needs to be looked at during the, as we discuss our contract negotiations. Now, they're all up now. So we need to look at that and see what we can do to try to streamline those things and make it a lot more transparent.
The Miami-Dade County Fire Department has released a new fire boat operations plan.
Right.
What do you think of the plan that they've released so far?
This is the plan that we wanted to do a year ago. We wanted to tender a boat, basically saying we put a person to make sure the boat is ready to go, maintain the boat, et cetera. And then when a call comes for the boat, the station that is at the Port of Miami, which only responds to about less than 1.5 calls a day, those personnel can jump on the boat and then respond to an emergency on the water.
I think what was popularly called cross-utilization.
Cross-utilization, exactly right. You know, and it's, you can't do that with all units. When you have a very, very busy unit, 4,000 calls a year, 3,000 calls a year, you can't do that. That you don't have, the odds are they may not be available for that. But when you have a unit that only runs about 600 times a year, that's the time that you can take advantage of cross-utilization and actually have those people respond in the appropriate vehicle, whether it be a boat, whether it be a rescue, whether it be an engine, to the call. And the fire union has been very, very opposed to such a concept. It's a concept that's used around the country, actually used in this county itself. If you look at Key Biscayne, that's exactly how they man and staff their fire apparatus. They have 8 people, but they have 4 apparatus. They jump on the appropriate vehicle depending on the call. That's all we ask of them, and so let's see what the union does when we put this in operation.
I did not understand why it was that if you were to increase and have a full-time crew for that, 4 people, it was going to cost $2.8 to $3.5 million.
Well, because that's what it costs to staff units nowadays. It costs over $2 million to put a unit in service. So it's not the cost of the apparatus itself. That's a one-time cost, probably every 10 or 15 years that you have to, buy it. It's actually the staffing costs are very, very expensive. In order to have a four-person unit in operation 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, you actually need 17 firefighters. Now, when you look at it on average, it's close to $100,000 each. You got $1.7 million right there just in manpower and staffing. Then you got to add fuel, the cost of the apparatus, et cetera, et cetera. So that cost really jumps pretty high.
The county commission tells the youth fair to find a new home and let FIU expand. There is a cost to breaking that contract.
Well, the youth fair contract says they're a tenant in our it's actually parkland. So number one, the first thing that has to happen is I've got to sit down with the parties and say, can we agree to something? And then bring that back to the commission. The commission then has to take it to the voters. The voters have to say okay. That's number one. The second thing is, and I made it very clear to FIU and all the parties involved, that the county, as county mayor, I will not tolerate 1 cent of expense to Miami-Dade County. If my FIU wants to expand, great. If we can work it out, great. The fair has to understand that they're a tenant. And so our contract says if we move you, we have the right to move them, as long as the voters say, okay, the expansion. And their contract says, okay, you can move us to a suitable location, and also you have to pay for whatever infrastructure we've built and for the cost of moving them. Again, that's not a cost that I'm willing to bear for Miami-Dade County. It's something that has to be borne entirely by FIU in the state of Florida.
Some people have suggested, and FIU, I believe, has some land that they want to donate to the county that's outside of the UDB, the urban boundary line. Acceptable or not acceptable to you?
I don't like that property outside the UDB right now, and I know that people want to, when I go there, I think there are other sites inside the UDB that we can move the fair itself to, that actually may work better for the fair. There's costs associated with that. Again, that's going to be borne by FIU, and I made that very clear. And it's not going to be.
What areas? What areas do you think are good areas?
There were some studies done. There are some properties around I-75 and the Turnpike that were looked at. That's private. There also has been some talk about the Tropical Park itself. There is the Santa's Enchanted Forest is there. For a number of months. That site is, and when I last time I went, it was almost like going back to the youth fair. I mean, a lot of the same rides, et cetera. Also, we've done a lot of work there with the equestrian center, mm-hmm. and so it may fit in the sense that A, you have good access both in and out. You've got two ways to go in on Bird and also on Miller. You're right next to Expressway. You're also it's a regional park. There's parking there, although additional parking may have to be created. And there you could take this opportunity to actually make Tropical Park better. That may be a location, but I'm not saying that that is the location. I'm just saying there is one. The Grand properties up north. We look down south. It's something in South Dade. It's something that this fair really doesn't want to do because they think that it's going to take away a lot of the people because it's so far. But there are other sites that we're looking at too.
Is David Beckham really being lured by Broward County to move his soccer stadium there?
Is he being lured? Yes, absolutely. I'm sure. I read it all the time that they're come here and go by Panther Arena, which I don't think is really a viable site for him.
Didn't specify what he said when he said waterfront. It could be a lake.
I don't think that that's what he had in mind. Now, I've spoken to the Beckham people. They are still looking at sites in Miami-Dade County, some private, most of them private, and some public. But, they'll come back. They said they'll come back in about 30 to 60 days and tell us what they would like and work out some kind of a plan. Again, everything that I've told them from the beginning, there will be no county funds. If you're on a county piece of property, then there's going to be, fair market value or rent. That's as far as the county is concerned. But anything else that we can to try to, bring you down, because, he is willing to build a stadium by himself. And maybe he can partner up with UM and get a new home for University of Miami a little bit closer to
Well, and of course, University of Miami is looking to use that facility as well.
Well, only if it's big enough, and it has to have at least 40,000 seats and the boxes, et cetera. And so that adds to the cost for soccer stadium. I mean, the Beckham Group is only looking for 20,000, 25,000 seats. University of Miami needs about 40,000 seats. And so that's, again, something, part of the equation that we have to look at. We're going to be very deliberate in how we do this because, I think we want MLS. I mean, with all the hoopla with World Cup that we just had a couple of weeks ago, soccer is the sport of the future here. And I know we have a lot of new residents that really are big soccer fans.
Absolutely. And it's always about location, location, location. And waterfront is considered precious, which is why some people are concerned, and we only have a minute left,
sure,
that Parcel B might be considered for a Cuban exile museum.
Well, the commission has directed me to come up with a plan. And so I will have to do my due diligence and come up with a plan. I think it was a unanimous vote for them. I have stated publicly that I wanted that to be parkland, but now the commission has directed me to do something else, and I do abide. I did swear to uphold the Constitution of the United States, the laws of the state of Florida, and also Miami-Dade County, and so as the mayor, even though I may want that to be parkland, that I have to do my best to see, to come make this come to fruition, because that's the direction that the commission wanted.
We're out of time. As always, thanks so much, Mayor, for joining us here on Issues.
It's my pleasure.